I'm on. Good morning, Jackson Baptist Church. Happy hot Sunday, folks. Welcome to August. We are exactly a month from school starting. I'm so excited, so excited. If it's your first time with us, yes, I am this excited for school because summer is way too long. But make sure you stop by the Connection Center, pick up some information about JBC. And if it's really your first time here, we'll give you a free Chick-fil-A gift card. Fun fact, this rock has been at the pulpit for like a month. So I was asking Brian, hey, why it's up here? He's like, I don't know. So we're going to leave it up here because we like having the rock with us. We have our weekly prayer services every Sunday morning, and Wednesday evening. You can see Tom Jeffroy for details. We have some Zoom components, some in-person components, so no reason not to pray. Okay. Hymn sing is tonight. So there was a great time last month. There was lots of laughter, shared stories, but it's tonight from 7 to 8:30-ish, and we'll be singing lots of different songs, and you know Brian's going to walk you through that when we get there, so good times. Our AV team in the back, we always thank you for what you do, and we are looking for some more folks that may be interested to serve in that ministry. Full training will be given. All you need is the desire to serve. See Jamie Zapata, and he will get you connected. Our JBC youth group, so it's here every Wednesday from 6:30 to 8. There's foods, games, Bible lessons. My kids come, and everybody always has a good time. It's open from youth age, grades 6 through 12. You can see Pastor Jamie. He's out sick today, but he'll be around here, and he'll give you the details as well. Awana, we've been discussing this for the last couple of weeks, so it is a free weekly children's club, and this one will serve ages 4 up to 6th grade, so right before youth group. So find Amanda Graga to volunteer. You can sign up on the JBC website as well. Definitely a fantastic opportunity to get involved, and Amanda's contact information is at the Connection Center. We have a new thing happening, our backpack distribution, so your help is needed. We're going to support our local students in need, and JBC will be filling backpacks that will be given out at our distribution event on Sunday, August 28th. Volunteers are also needed to help with setup following the service that day and for distribution. So if you can help, please see the table in the foyer when you first walk in or walk out. We have our nursery available for all our little ones during the worship service. And fun fact here, if you missed the ICR presentation, we have it on the JBC website, the one that was given last night. So feel free to go to the JBC YouTube, and then you can get it there. And then we ask you to silence your cell phones, and our prayer team will be available at the end of the service.
Also remember, at the end of service, if you are needing prayer, or you know anyone that needs prayer that you can intercessory pray for, we will have our prayer warriors up here. Please come forward for that. Please stand. We are going to be speaking to God in prayer. Normally I ask you to stand for the call to worship. I'm sorry, we are in the presence of God. You need to stand. Let's pray. Lord, as we gather today to sing your praises and hear your word and fellowship together, we ask that you bless this service and keep our minds on you throughout today, throughout the week. Please be with the man you have in store for our new pastor and bless him and prepare our hearts for his arrival. Amen. Our call to worship today is Psalm 33, verses 1 through 3. Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make music to him on the 10-stringed lyre. That's straight for you guys. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully and shout for joy. We are going to open our hearts today. We are going to let our hearts cry to the Lord. Let's sing.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, so I can walk in your truth. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and make me wholly devoted to you. Oh, oh, oh. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Open my eyes so I can see the wonderful things that you do. Open my heart up more and more and make me wholly devoted to you. Oh, oh, oh. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. All of the days of my life. All of the days of my life.
Whew, amen. You know, I was thinking this the other day. I hope when you're applauding, that you are not applauding yourselves or anyone on this stage. The applause that you give needs to be straight to God. Amen and amen. It is the cry of my heart, Lord, to be close to you. One of the other things that our heart can cry out for is to build his kingdom. For him to build his kingdom here. Now, you could take this literally to say on this planet, but the way that I always look at this song that we're about to sing is that I want you to build your kingdom here, in me, through me, so that we can work together to continue that kingdom as well.
Set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Church, we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. We refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth.
Lift it up.
Build your kingdom. Are the hope on earth.
Yes, lift that praise up to God. One of the easiest ways to make sure that God is working through you and being able to build his kingdom through you and in you is by your brothers around you. Like this guy right here. This song actually came out of the Promise Keepers group a couple decades ago. Now, it says man to man over and over and over again and brother to brother, but that does not disclude the women. Okay? You can think of man to man as mankind to mankind if you wish.
Side by side, brother to brother, we'll honor each other as men of the kingdom on high.
Let me hear it, guys.
Back to back, warrior to warrior, back to back, defending each other, standing together, we're building the kingdom of God. Shoulder, back to back, younger and older, growing together, we're building the kingdom, working together, we're building the kingdom, standing together, we're building the kingdom of God, we're building the kingdom of God, we're building the kingdom of God.
That's exactly why we are on this planet, to spread the news and build the kingdom so that God can work through you to get to the lives of others. Please be seated. This would be the time in the service when we take the offering. Now again, if you are a visitor here, do not feel the need, unless the Holy Spirit leads you, to give to this offering. This is mostly for those who attend here regularly and the members of JBC.
Thank you.
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Amen. Please stand for the doxology. Our doxology this month is Step by Step. God, you are my God, and I will follow you all of my days. I thank you so much, Lord, for the gifts that you give us, for the gifts that you give us of music and of preaching and of teaching and just fellowship. We ask, Father, that you would accept these gifts as we humbly bring them back before you again so that your kingdom can be continued. Amen. If those assisting with the communion would come forward.
Is this on? Well, welcome this morning as we gather together at the Lord's table. As is our custom, the Lord instructs us in his word that as often as we gather together in his name, we'll remember him as we partake of the elements. I'm going to ask Brother Steve if he'll pray over the bread.
Okay. Lord God, we just come before you today and remember what you did for us on the cross. We know we're not worthy to receive you and all that it means to get us into heaven, Father, but you willingly came down from heaven and left your glory, became one of us, and then suffered the most humiliating death possible, all so that we could enjoy heaven and eternity with you, and we are so grateful. Thank you for what you've done. Amen.
The Apostle Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" As we stand here together, we heard our songs earlier. Brother to brother, shoulder to shoulder. I'm shoulder to shoulder with a person I've never met before. But I can call him my brother because he's my brother in Christ. We are here, elders of this church and servants of the Lord, doing the best we can to keep this church together going forward while we're waiting for our new pastor to come. That said, our other pastor was very organized and had things right in order. Not so much today. We weren't aware that we were going to have to rearrange things. And so we're stumbling through this right now by God's grace. And I just ask for God's grace on the other side because I obviously prayed over the bread sooner than I should have. So I'm going to just go with this. I think God is sitting in heaven looking at us and laughing and saying it's not the order of the service, it's the order of your heart in the service. Amen? So now I'm going to ask my brother to pray over the cup.
Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much just for the opportunity to serve together, Lord God, to worship together, Lord, to remember together, Lord. Every month that we get to do this, I get a vision of what it's going to be like in heaven, Lord, with our brothers and sisters together just worshiping, Lord, keeping our eyes focused on you. So we take this time, Father, any unconfessed sin, anything in our minds, may we just focus on you, and we thank you for what you've done already, Lord. Thank you.
In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup, the new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes."
I'd like us to distribute the elements, and after we're all served, we'll come and have a final prayer as we partake together. Amen. Scriptures go on further in 1 Corinthians and tell us that we need to reflect upon the manner in which we receive the cup and the bread. We don't want to take it in an unworthy manner. We don't want to have any unforgiveness in our heart towards anyone, because that will remove the Lord's blessing from us, and it could even hinder us, and some say become sick because of it. So I'd like to just take a moment to reflect. And let's just let God look at our heart and see if there be anything in it that he wants us to be removed. Father, I thank you that you sent Jesus. And Jesus, I thank you that you were obedient to the Father and allowed your body to be broken for us. As we eat this wafer, we remember the brokenness that you went through that we might be free. Let's eat together.
Amen. as we continue communion, we remember how the Lord used the cup as a symbol of his shed blood for us. And it's a wonderful shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It resulted in the remission of sins. And so we thank the Lord for that. And I also think about this event happening 2,000 years ago. And here we are in the 21st century, still remembering the Lord's Supper. I think that's incredible. And so let's have a prayerful attitude and rejoice as we drink the cup.
Well, it's my privilege to be able to be the elder to lead us in prayer today and also focus on our missions moment. Very good. There were supposed to be some other slides, however. I'm informed that the JBC kids can be dismissed. Isn't grace wonderful? So the focus for our missions moment this week is for Nelson and Consuela Juarez. JBC kids are gone. And now Mission Door in El Salvador. We're going to be praying for them today. Nelson is the pastor of Vida Abundante Te Iglesia Bautista. Forgive me, I do not speak Spanish. The Abundant Life Baptist Church of El Salvador. Thank you for the translation. The church has grown from a very small group of people praising God to a thriving community of believers. He is also a church planter in Guatemala and Belize. He is the international coordinator for North and Central America with Missions Door. This June, they celebrated 28 years of ministry in El Salvador. 28 years of ministry in El Salvador. And we joined together with them in a lot of that. Praise God. Praise God for his faithfulness. Did we lose this? Nelson also thanks Jackson Baptist Church. It's not on. Thank you, David. Is that better? Thank you, David. He always keeps me in line. Nelson also thanks Jackson Baptist Church for the prayers and support for their ministry. Nelson does ask for us to continue to pray for the building of new church in Acajeda, is that it? I'm not sure. And Pastor Carlos Molina, they have a training program in Santa Ana and San Salvador. And he also asked for prayer for his children who are endeavoring to go into dentistry and medicine. So if we could pray. I'm going to pray for our missionaries, but I also want to pray for JBC in this time of transition for us. As you can see, things are different and they're moving different, and we have a lot of opportunities to grumble and complain, but we have even more opportunities to just laugh it off and say, you know, this is life, okay? Father in heaven, I just thank you and praise you for my brothers and sisters here. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that your presence is here as well. Lord, you've heard what the needs are in the mission field for Nelson and Consuela, Lord, in the ministry that they're involved in. We ask that you continue to bless them, continue to guard them and protect them and their children, and release to them all the funds that they need, all the support they need, and the personnel as well. And Lord, I just lift up JBC to you now. I ask you, Father, you would bless us. Hold us together that we might be able to love each other with an unconditional love. And Father, that we would not be disturbed or concerned about things that don't go the way they always did, but that we would be excited about how things are going to go according to you in our future. And we give it to you now. And we invite you now to just bless this church and bless this message which is forthcoming in Jesus' name. Amen? At this time, I'd like to introduce and invite our speaker Frank Sherwin from ICR. Some of you have already heard him already, and we're about to hear some more. And one of the things I really like about ICR is it just proves that we are standing on a firm foundation. I mean, you look at the Bible, you open it up, and then you look at the reality. There's nothing that isn't true in the Word of God. And I thank God that He has let us know that we are on that firm foundation. So, brother, will you come, please?
All right.
I'm going to shut this off.
Okay, Jamie, is this on? Is that good? Yeah, there we go. All right. Well, folks, it's good to be here this morning in the Lord's house, just celebrating the Lord's Supper. This is the first time I've ever done that, as a matter of fact, and so I'm very honored to be able to be part of the Lord's Supper and distributing the elements. That's wonderful. There's something else, too, that's kind of exciting, and that is during the song service, we used Psalm 33, and that just happens to be, as the ancient philosopher said, surprise, surprise, one of my favorite psalms. And so, as a matter of fact, this time next week, Lord willing, I'm going to be speaking to an adult Sunday school class. What's going to be my subject? Answer, Psalm 33. So it's kind of neat how that all works out. So this morning, just the brief time that we have, Jamie, what time do I have to be done?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock. All right. That's not enough time, but that's okay. The average speaking speed is 190 words per minute. I'm going to have to clip right along at 300 with gusts up to 450. Okay. So anyway, yeah, so good. Thanks, Jamie. I appreciate that. You know, traveling around with Bruce and I, Mr. Bruce Wood in the back row there, and we have to stay at a variety of motels through the years and all that, but last night I just slept like a baby at that motel. I woke up every 2 hours and cried, but no, I didn't. It was good. It was a good time. So this morning, what we're going to do, as I say, in the brief time that we have, is look at so-called human evolution. And before I do that, just some sobering statistics. About 30% of U.S. adults are now religiously unaffiliated. That's almost one-third of U.S. adults. Self-identified Christians make up 63% of the U.S. population in 2021. That was down from 75% a decade ago. One of the sadder statistics I can share with you this morning. And we should be salt and light, should we not, in this society, in this generation. And we can just see society just taking a nosedive. But we have to stay faithful, do we not? And so man was created is what we maintained at ICR, and the Lord God formed man in the dust of the ground and the breath into his and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul, according to Genesis chapter 2. Man was created uniquely through animals, though animals also possess the breath, that is the Hebrew word neshama, and the soul, the Hebrew word nefesh. Man's breath, the same word as spirit and soul, were imparted to him by God directly rather than indirectly as imparted to the animals. So we are uniquely created in God's image. We are not animals. We are created in God's image. And the saddest thing that I can share this morning is that our tax dollars are being used to teach the next generation that they are just highly evolved animals. And that is totally incorrect. We are created in God's image to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Well, is human evolution a fact? This is what we hear in the media, universities, colleges, and unfortunately, even a lot of Christian colleges and schools as well. But man did not evolve from ape-like ancestors. The human family tree has been shaken up at least four times just in 2019. Four times. And that happens regularly every single year. A fact that indicates how fragile and problematic the evidence for quote-unquote human evolution. Now, I put it in quotation marks because human evolution is, what do they call it, an oxymoron. That's like saying airline food, okay? And jumbo shrimp. Right. Microsoft works. And so, for example, look at this from Nature Magazine. Nature Magazine is no fan of the creationist. This was said in August 28th, back in 2019. Ancient cranium discovered in Ethiopia suggests early hominin evolutionary tree is messier than we thought. Folks, we keep seeing statistics and quotes like that all the time. Several times a year, they uncover some shattered remains of a fossil and understand that, oh no, what are we going to say about human evolution now? Because once again, they have to go back to square one and begin again trying to describe so-called human evolution. Scientific American, just about, way back in the year 2020, said the human saga, we now understand, is far more intricate than scholars of yore envisioned. The tiny troops of our prehistory have collapsed under the weight of evidence. Look at that. Collapsed under the weight of evidence. There is no single missing link that bridges apes and humankind. Well, amen to that. No drumbeat march of progress toward a predestined goal. And then they said, our story is complicated, messy, and random. Did you get that this morning, folks? The evolutionary community in Scientific American, which hates creationists, says that our story, meaning human evolution, is complicated, messy, and random. You know what I would suggest this morning? Since our hard-earned tax dollars are being used to teach the next generation of human evolution, it's only fair that they be taught the whole issue. And that would maybe include this quote. Could we put this quote in American taxpayer-paid public school biology textbooks? I say yes. There's plenty of room in the wide white margins that they have to put a quote like this. There's no reference to the Bible, no reference to creation science. As a matter of fact, this is written by a dyed-in-the-wool, USDA-inspected evolutionist. And so it would be very, I think, a breath of intellectual fresh air for the student in high school or junior high to read that our story is complicated, messy, and random. They can say everything they want about human evolution, just include this quote. And I would say that's what we would call a balanced treatment. Well, look at this. How and when modern humans first emerged as a species is a major unanswered question in paleoanthropology because the fossil record is incomplete. The timing and nature of early modern human dispersal out of Africa has long been disputed among scholars, with competing theories or models about, there it is again, how and when it all occurred in 2014. So these are all recent 21st century quotes regarding this strange idea that says that people came from ape-like ancestors through the alleged millions of years of time. They just don't know how, and they don't know when. Other than that, human evolution is a fact. This is from my dictionary of zoology that I have in my office in Dallas. It's written by Michael Alibi. He's the editor of this dictionary of zoology. He hates creationists, and it comes across in some of the definitions that he has in this dictionary of zoology, and this is just 2 years old. He said, the time at which the hominid line diverged from that of the African apes, that is, the gorillas and chimps, is what? Controversial. Times of as much as 20 million and as little as 4.5 million years ago are, there's a good scientific word, suggested. Once again, let's go ahead and use this quote from a prestigious secular dictionary of zoology and place that in American public taxpayer-paid public school biology textbooks. Again, no scripture, no Bible there, no creation. But again, the students would be seeing the other side of the story. So what's the key tool used in human evolution studies? Well, the answer may surprise you, but the key tool that they use is that of imagination. You ever think about that? In human evolution studies, they use a whole lot of imagination. As a matter of fact, I like this cartoon here. It's an old cartoon, but it's a good one. The nanny is reading to a young Charles Darwin, and she's saying, "The princess kissed the frog, and it changed into a handsome prince." And young Darwin is saying, "Boy, when I grow up, I'm going to write stuff like that." Sorry, but I had to include that cartoon. And some people get upset when I show this and say, "You're making light of Darwinism." Well, not really, because look at this quote. As an individual said, "A person's imagination must fill up the very wide blanks." Can I repeat that? A person's imagination must fill up the very wide blanks. Here's a question of the morning. Who said that? Very good. Charles Darwin said that in a letter to an individual by the name of Gray in 1857. 2 years later, Darwin published his infamous book on the origin of species that turned the Western world upside down. But 2 years before, as you see that, he's appealing to what class? Imagination, appealing to imagination. Here is an individual by the name of Peter Dodson. He is a 100% evolutionist, and I was in the video display at the museum in Dallas called the Perot Museum, which is totally worships the creation and not the creator, as the Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 1. And I watched the Peter Dodson video over and over again. I wanted to get the quote exactly right. He said, quote, "I have to tell you that imagination is a very, very important trait for those who study the fossil record," end quote. And again, what a wonderful thing to put into the fossil section of American taxpayer-paid public schools. So what is imagination? Well, it's a noun, and Webster's New World Dictionary says it's the act or power of forming a mental image of what is not present. And certainly that is true with the strange, bizarre idea that says that we came from ape-like ancestors. So evolutionists disagree, of course, insisting that there is clear evidence that people came from lower life forms. And so let's look at urban legends in human evolution. Now, I could go through and talk about Australopithecus afarensis and Ardi and Homo habilis and Homo erectus and all of these other so-called missing links, but I think it's important that we just go ahead and stay on the fundamentals this morning, and then you can buy some of the books in the back table there and read about the details. But let's look at some of these fake news or urban legends, as they call it. First of all, beginning with anatomy, as we look at these fake news or urban legends, and that is back problems. How many here, I don't want a show of hands, but how many here have been told at one time or another that people with back problems it's because we only recently in geologic time learned how to walk upright. So people have back problems because we just recently, millions of years ago, learned to walk upright. And you can see some of the problematic postures that people have there. Well, that gets into something called bipedalism. Bi means two. Pedalism means using your feet, okay? So using 2 feet. And so this evolution of bipedalism is what evolutionists refer to. And we would ask the question, is the evolution of bipedalism, that's walking, the cause of our back problems? So there's a lot of questions there. You know, did we recently learn to walk upright as a species? And is that the reason why we have all the back problems today? Oh, he can walk upright, he just hasn't had his coffee yet. I thought it was funny. Okay. Here's the first recorded upright walking human. Ta-da! Okay. Exactly why and when our ancestors stood upright and started moving around on 2 feet is shrouded in what class? Mystery. It's shrouded in mystery, according to the BBC, which is no friend of the creationist. Then Richmond and his fellow authors said in the American Journal of Physical Anthropology, and I quote, "Some of the most long-standing questions," no pun intended, "in paleoanthropology concern how and why human bipedalism evolved." They don't know why we decided as a species to decide to stand upright and get off of all fours. It's always been a mystery, and it always will be a mystery. Why? Because we have been created in the beginning, thousands of years ago, to walk upright. We didn't learn to walk on all fours and then upright, as a humanist, as the evolutionists insist. Up to 90% of all Americans suffer at least one debilitating episode of back pain during their lives. Back pain is one of the leading causes of disability around the world. In the U.S. alone, it costs $635, look at that, billion dollars per year in medical bills and loss of productivity, all due to back problems. And so is this because of Darwinism? Is this because we've only recently learned to walk upright? And the answer is categorically no, it is not. Here, let me give you an example. I saw that you have a ministry of filling backpacks, you know, your backpack ministry. Heavy backpacks or bags can lead to back problems and poor posture, according to NBC News. So be careful about how much that you put into your backpack if you're a young person, because it really can cause adverse effects on your posture. I could not believe this statistic. About 5,000 children visit emergency rooms each year because of backpack-related injuries, okay? And so kind of have to be careful about that. Does this have anything to do with evolution? Shake your head like this. No, this has nothing to do with evolution. This has everything to do with people having very, very heavy backpacks, for example, causing problems that result in 5,000 young people going to the emergency room and messing up their backs. Nothing to do with bipedalism and evolutionary naturalism. Nothing to do with Darwinian evolution at all. So what is the cause of back problems? Answer, lack of exercise, too much sitting, obesity, bad habits, or maybe injury like a car accident or something. Other reasons that are not due to evolution. And so there is perfectly easy and simple reasons why we have problems to their back. And it's got nothing to do with evolution. As a matter of fact, a lot of these companies now are having their employees stand up if they want to do their work, because otherwise they have poor posture and results in back problems. And so I think this is called the Very Desk or whatever else. And I was interested as to where this first was invented, because it's in Coppell, Texas, which is just a stone's throw from the ICR main offices. And speaking of ICR, about half of our employees now have this Very Desk that they work from, standing up. And because you've heard the phrase that sitting is the new smoking, have you heard that before? Yeah, as people understand, smoking will kill you. Now they're understanding that if you just sit and have a very sedentary type lifestyle, not only are you not getting any kind of cardiovascular stimulation, but it messes up your back as well if you have poor posture. Well, I like this phrase, and I use it a lot as I talk to people, as I lecture. ABC, anything but creation. You can have the most outstanding, incredible, bizarre explanations, but it's better than what? Creation. This has got to take the cake here, folks. I couldn't believe it, and I thought, I got to share this with God's people. Because here is a quote-unquote explanation as to why we started walking upright. Okay, are you ready? Exploding stars. Exploding stars may, I like that word, perhaps trigger ecological changes on Earth, which might in turn have led humans to embrace two-legged life. Okay, they call us unscientific, and yet, why did we start walking upright? Well, it's because a star exploded ever so many millions of years ago, way out there, and it caused the animals on all fours to start walking upright. That's a stretch. That really is a stretch. Initiating, the article says, an avalanche of electrons in the lower atmosphere and setting off a chain of events that feasibly ended with bipedal hominins, people walking upright, all due to exploding stars. I don't think so. Okay, that's such a stretch that doesn't even warrant discussion. Well, this is one of my favorite books on the back table there. It's Creation Facts of Life by Dr. Gary Parker, my dear friend and mentor way back in the early 80s. And it contains an excellent section on human evolution. Dr. Parker has a very engaging writing style, easy to follow. He doesn't get into a lot of heavy science or anything, but you'd find yourself very well prepared after studying Dr. Parker's book. It's only three chapters, and one chapter is on fossils, where he talks about human evolution. This is a must for young people in junior high, high school, and even going off to college and university. This is a great reference book to have. Well, let's talk about vestigial organs, so-called, and I like to address the molars, our teeth, and this is what Scientific American said just a couple of years ago. And, of course, humans are replete with useless vestigial structures. That is, like our appendix, our tonsils, molars, and so forth. A distinctive sign of our evolutionary ancestry, such as wisdom teeth. So they're using wisdom teeth as vestigial organs, structures that we don't need or use anymore, that are a leftover from our evolutionary process. And sure enough, on occasion, yes, there are dental problems where you have impacted molars or the molars come in sideways or whatever else. We're not disputing that. Sometimes that does happen. But let's look at wisdom tooth removal. Has nothing to do with evolution and everything to do with diet. Is it not interesting, folks, that these industrial societies have a lot of problems with impacted wisdom teeth or wisdom teeth that come in and cause problems because we don't stimulate the jaw? In third world countries, people have a very, very high fiber diet, which initiates a lot of heavy chewing. This heavy chewing results in development of the jaw, which in turn helps the teeth to come in a average, ordinary way. But because we eat such refined foods, for example, in these industrial countries like the United States, where the most significant thing we bite into is a Big Mac, it doesn't really stimulate mandibular or jaw development, which then affects the teeth coming in. So that's something to keep in mind. Does that have anything to do with evolution? It has got nothing at all to do with evolution. So this is once again an example that evolutionists give that simply does not work. A researcher concluded that most prophylactic, the third molar extractions, are medically unnecessary, and the proper course is to clinically and radiographically monitor the teeth to determine pathological changes that indicate a clear need for extraction. And so what you can do is simply monitor how the teeth are coming in and then make a decision, but not just pull the teeth out willy-nilly because of evolution. We know that evolution doesn't work. And so when it comes to extraction of wisdom teeth, monitor it before you decide to extract the teeth. What about the tooth origin? Since we talk a lot about teeth, and what time do you go to the dentist? Tooth hurty? Tooth hurty. Be true to your teeth, and they won't be false to you. Sorry. Look at what this evolutionist said. Peter Ungar. Well, wait a minute. We talked about Peter Ungar earlier, where he said using your imagination. But anyway, he said the details of when, where, why, and how teeth first appeared still elude consensus. So they still don't know when, where, why, and how teeth first appeared. Teeth show up in the fossil record as what, class? Teeth. Teeth show up in the fossil record as teeth. See how easy science is? Okay. Dinosaurs show up in the fossil record as dinosaurs. People show up in the fossil record as people. Very rarely, I might add, but they still there. And then teeth have always been teeth in the fossil record, and we see all sorts of varieties there. Anyway, I won't go into that anymore, but this is what an evolutionist said in the 21st century. When, where, why, and how. Otherwise, evolution is a fact. The Fossil Record is a book that Dr. John Morris and I wrote. It contains a section on quote-unquote human evolution. I thoroughly enjoyed co-authoring this book with Dr. John Morris. I wrote the last one-third of it where I addressed the so-called missing links, and I used quotes from leading evolutionary publications to make the case that these are not missing links at all. Folks, I never had such an enjoyable time co-authoring as a book as writing the appendix for this book, The Fossil Record, showing time after time after time again that those are not true missing links at all. And so this has been also revised and updated. And so avail yourself, if you would, getting it. By the way, this is a good coffee table book. So you put it out there on the coffee table. It's got some beautiful color plates, but it also has good creation science as well. Well, this brings us to the coccyx, those four fused bones at the base of the spinal cord. And if you don't think the coccyx is important, then slip on the ice in February and fall on it. Then you realize how important the coccyx is, because you can't sit, you can't lie down, you can't roll over, you can't do anything except moan and groan for days or perhaps weeks, because you know, hitting the coccyx is no fun. And so the evolutionists maintain that our tailbone is a vestige, a leftover from our evolutionary ancestors when they had a tail. And yet, as the old saying goes, nothing could be further from the truth. The vertebral column is a linear row of bones that supports the head at its beginning. And, well, it's got to end somewhere, doesn't it? Where it ends, the evolutionist will be sure to call it a vestigial tail. Now, one of the functions of our skeleton, our internal skeleton, is the attachment site for what? Muscles, right, attachment site for muscles. Is that true for the coccyx? Shake your head like this. Yes, the coccyx has muscles attached to it. And so we have to ask the question, okay, there's muscles attached to the coccyx. What is the function of those muscles? I don't want to go into too much detail this morning, but it helps with something called the defecation reflex. Okay, kind of read between the lines there. And so I don't know why the evolutionists think that the coccyx might be a useless evolutionary vestige. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we at ICR offer the evolutionary community a friendly challenge. Get a volunteer to go under the knife, go into surgery, and have their coccyx removed. After all, it's a useless evolutionary vestige, and so we will go ahead and pay for them to have their coccyx removed. Then they can tell us, you know, whether it's an evolutionary vestige or not. By the way, we'll pay for the surgery, but we won't pay for the diapers for that individual that they will need for the rest of their lives, okay? Remember the site of attachment and the muscles and so forth. And so they've never taken us up on that. Folks, the coccyx is not a useless evolutionary vestige, I can assure you. Human saliva versus chimp saliva. Boy, we're shifting gears pretty quickly here. But you would think, you know, saliva is saliva, and it's probably the same as a saliva in chimpanzee. And the answer is, it is not. It is absolutely not. Very, very different. So this is a salivary proteome, some protein found in saliva. 99% of our saliva is water, very good. See how easy science is? 99% of our saliva is water. That 1% is pretty important. So here we find the humans, chimpanzees, the gorillas, and the macaques, and we find that the humans have their protein concentration right down here. Look at the chimpanzees way up here. The gorillas way up here, and the macaques somewhere around here. But human saliva is quite unique to the human species, and of course, we're not surprised. The secular authors said in 2019, we found that humans produce a waterier saliva. Is that a word? Waterier saliva, containing less than half total protein than great apes and old world monkeys. So very, very different, as we might expect, since we are created in God's image and that we did not evolve from these other creatures. Human saliva is 99.5% water. I lied. It's 99.5% water. So we discovered unique protein profiles in saliva of humans that were distinct from those of non-human primates, said this individual. And these are the parotid glands and the mandibular glands that secrete saliva in people. And I took histology a couple of times in college and graduate school. And so they're very, very different. So once again, it shows the difference between the chimpanzees, our alleged evolutionary relative, and people are quite different. How about our appendix and our tonsils? Are those useless? No, absolutely not. Now, can you live without your appendix and tonsils? Yes, you can. You can live with it. That's not proof that there are evolutionary vestiges, because you would do better if you kept them, right? Because the appendix and the tonsils are made of something called lymphatic tissue. Lymphatic tissue is tissue that helps to program certain white blood cells in our bloodstream called lymphocytes. Every 100th blood cell that is going through your body right now is a white blood cell of some kind, such as basophil, eosinophil, neutrophil, or these lymphocytes. But they're very, very important. And look at this. This comes from Live Science just a couple of years ago. If Darwin had been aware of the species that have an appendix attached to a large cecum, and if he had known about the widespread nature of the appendix, he probably would not have thought of the appendix as a vestige of evolution. Now, Darwin said that in the 1850s when they didn't understand a lot about the human physiology and anatomy. But in 2009, they're saying, you know, Darwin should have thought about that a little bit more. And Saladin, writing in his Human Anatomy book, said, the appendix is densely populated with lymphocytes and a significant source of immune cells. And so this is some of the immune system tissues that are so vitally important in our body. We can live without our appendix. We can live without our tonsils. But you'd do better if you had them. Duke scientists and collaborators from the University of Arizona and Arizona State University conclude that Darwin was what, class? Wrong. The appendix is a whole lot more than an evolutionary remnant, end quote. So that's great when you hear that from the evolutionary community. So it's called the vermiform appendix. It's a Latin phrase. And the appendix is about the size of your little finger. And it is provided with just one blood vessel. Sometimes that one blood vessel that keeps the appendix perfused with blood in terms of oxygen and food becomes occluded. It becomes blocked. And then you have what's called an appendicitis. It doesn't have anything to do with evolution. The appendix is densely populated with lymphocytes and significant other cells. It wasn't long ago when tonsils were routinely removed in children, partly on the belief that they were useless vestiges of an evolutionary past. What creationists now call, I love this phrase, evolutionary medical malpractice. Okay, and I was born and raised in the Chicagoland area back in the 19... I forget, sometime around there. And it was a time when all of my friends got their tonsils taken out. If there was any kind of upper respiratory problem, they just took the tonsils out as a manner of procedure. And so now we have a whole generation of individuals that don't have their tonsil. Have you ever heard about people that go in some abdominal work and while they're under the knife and under the general anesthetic, the physician, the surgeon will go ahead and just take out the appendix because it's a useless vestige? They used to do that all the time until people started suing the individual, because I did not give you permission to take out my appendix. Now they don't do that at all unless the individual specifically asks for that. And so, evolutionary medical malpractice. Dr. Gary Parker, in his book, Creation Facts of Life, talks all about this in wonderful, wonderful way of describing it. Well, moving right along, we just have a few minutes. Have you ever heard the 98.4% argument? People and chimpanzees have 98.4% the same DNA. Have you heard that before? And therefore, we are linked inextricably with the chimpanzee. Now, I've always been suspicious of that, because looking physically, in genetics, we call it phenotypically, physically, there's a big, big difference between a chimpanzee and you. Okay? And yet, the DNA is supposedly 98.4% the same? I don't think so. And this is where Rupi and Sanford talk about the genetic evidence, chapter 13. Bruce has this book out in the back table there, Contested Bones. This is a fantastic book that helps to describe the creation science perspective regarding humans, and chapter after chapter exposing the myth of human evolution. I love this book. This is really needed in your creation science library, as it describes the problems with human evolution, which are legion. Read about the four profound genetic problems with ape to man evolution. Four profound genetic problems right there in this book, Contested Bones. Genomes are not recipes. A creature that shares 98.4% DNA with humans is not 98.4% human any more than a fish shares, say, 40% of its DNA with a person is human. Are there fish out there that have 40% the same DNA as people? Answer is yes, they are, okay? Why? Well, because fish have to eat, don't they? So they eat proteins, and they eat carbohydrates, and they eat fats, just like people. That means a lot of their genetic makeup has genes that break down proteins, break down fats, break down carbohydrates. The same genetic information, but not because we came from a common ancestor, we came from a common designer, a common designer. And so even rats and mice have a lot of the DNA in their body that is the same as human DNA. But rats and mice and chimpanzees eat the same food, drink the same water, breathe the same air. And because of that, a lot of the DNA is the same because we live in the same environment. We eat the same food. Yes, an amount of DNA would be exactly the same. Once again, that is not a common ancestor. It's a common designer. We share half our genes with the banana. Half of our genes with the banana, right? And so, and that's what Robert May, a chief UK scientist, said 22 years ago. But it's in New Scientist magazine, no friend of the creationist. And so, there's a significant difference between people and bananas, and yet we share half of our genes the same. Moving right along, and we're done. For about 23% of our genome, we share no immediate genetic ancestry with our closest living relative, the chimpanzee. That was said in 2007. These are secular authors writing in the prestigious Molecular Biology and Evolution magazine, and they say 23% of our genome is unique to people. Almost one out of four protein in our body is unique from other creatures. And that's very significant. It's now clear that the genetic differences between people and chimpanzees are far more extensive than previously thought. Their genomes are not 98 or 99% identical. This comes from the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, which is no friend of the creationist. So they are saying also that this idea of people and chimpanzees sharing such a significant portion of DNA is simply incorrect. And so we are not some kind of shadow of our evolutionary ancestor, the chimpanzee. Jeff Tompkins, a PhD in genetics, has written a number of articles for the ICR website, and you can read all about it at icr.org. To conclude here this morning, folks, Acts chapter 17 and verse 26, the apostle says, "And hath made one blood of all nations of men." There is only one race, and that's the human race. We have been created in God's image to have fellowship with Him through the person of Jesus Christ. We read about this creation account in Genesis chapter 2. And so man did not rise up from the apes. We have been created in God's image, and we have acknowledged that when we have the Lord's Supper, do we not? As we celebrate what the Lord Jesus has done for us 2,000 years ago on the cross. And so in conclusion this morning, I just want to share with you the C's of the Bible. We have creation in Genesis chapter 1, right? And then we have the corruption of the creation in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, where Satan's first words are, "Did God really say that?" So from the creation, we have the corruption. And then God cursed the earth, didn't he? He cursed the earth with what? Weeds, thorns, thistles. My field is parasites. I'm a parasitologist, an invertebrate zoologist. And so parasites are part of the curse, are they not? Can I show you in the Bible? I can't, because parasites are not mentioned in the Bible. But it seems to make sense that when God cursed the earth, a lot of these what we call free-living animals out in the environment became parasitic in people, plants, and animals. So God cursed the earth with weeds and thorns and thistles. And mutations, parasites, definitely telemarketers, okay? So what are the C's so far? Creation, corruption, curse, and then God sent a flood that we talked about in the equipping hour, right? The flood, that was what we would call a catastrophe, right? Catastrophe, Genesis chapter 6 through Genesis chapter 8. Then on into the New Testament, we read about the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, the other C, and three C's with the Lord Jesus Christ, the cradle, the cross, and the crown. And then finally, at the end of all, we find in the Bible, the book of Revelation, right? The book of Revelation. Can we say this morning that's the consummation of all things? So let's put it all together and we're done. Creation, corruption, curse, catastrophe, the Lord Jesus Christ, the cradle, the cross, and the crown, and then the consummation of all things as we see the Lord Jesus Christ coming back again in power and in glory. Amen. Amen. So we would ask that you would pray for us at the Institute for Creation Research as we are on the cutting edge of this vital and important issue called origins. As the late Henry Morris said, where you came from is at least as important as to where you're going. So that would include studying to show yourself approved unto God, getting the DVDs that are available out there, such as Discovering Dinosaurs, The Mighty Ocean, and The Truth of the Genesis Flood by Dr. Tim Cleary. These are great items to have in your growing creation science library. Then we find also other books that are available, such as the Ocean Book that I wrote, and it has been revised and updated. There's also the book on dinosaurs. We love dinosaurs at ICR. This is what you read to your kids and your grandkids, okay? And they'll enjoy reading all about that. What do we call dinosaurs at ICR? We call them missionary lizards, okay? Because dinosaurs, according to the fossil record, have always been dinosaurs. There's no indication that dinosaurs came from any other pre-dinosaur creature. No, dinosaurs appear suddenly and fully formed in the fossil record as dinosaurs. And so avail yourself, please, to the books and DVDs we have out there. And Jamie, I'm going to go ahead and close in prayer. Is that all right, Steve? Okay, let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you again so much for this time that we come apart to worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you for the Lord's Supper that we had this morning as we acknowledge what you did on the cross for us 2,000 years ago. We ask that you give us journey's mercies as we travel and give us a good rest of the day. Help us to prepare spiritually for the coming week. We pray in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, we want to thank ICR for coming to present all of this to us. Again, if you missed last night's session and you would like to see that, it is available on YouTube. You can go straight to the Jackson Baptist site through YouTube and find it that way. Please stand while we close our service with Light the Fire. Spirit moves through me like a let that be your prayer daily, every morning. Light the fire again. Now, as you leave this place, know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are created by God. You are a child of God, created in His image. There are people out there that don't know. They need to know. We have the answer. They need that answer. Let's get to work.
Just a last-minute announcement. Anybody, if you hadn't already heard, Kathy Nyman's son, Paul, passed away recently. There's going to be a service here on Saturday, August 13th at 10:30. So for those of you that know Kathy and the rest of the family here, the Tuckers, all of them, Paul passed away. They're going to have a service on the 13th. So thanks.